In April of 1992, Chris McCandless hitchhiked from South Dakota to Alaska, where he walked into the wilderness of Denali National Park to live in freedom and solitude. Sadly, he never returned. He would later be found deceased inside of an old, rusted out, abandoned bus, and with him was a personal journal that recorded really a page-turning story that we're gonna use to start our time together as we continue the sermon series we're in called It's a Page-Turner. Now, I know that's a grim way to begin, and I'll finish the story here in a second. It really does speak into our subject for today. But before I finish the story, I want to introduce myself to anyone who may not know who I am. My name is Jeff Maness. I am the senior pastor here, and I am just so, so thankful that all of you have chosen to connect with us today. Here is the last known picture Chris took of himself. He is seen sitting in front of the bus where he was later found deceased. And while much remains a mystery about his death, what's clear is his disdain for conformity and for materialism. He desperately wanted to live in complete solitude, free from money, possessions, even people, believing that we don't need community in order to thrive. The last person to see him alive tried to buy him proper equipment, offered him a map, even offered some advice about the rough terrain and the elements that he would experience there in the wilderness, but he refused that person's help and support. He walked into the wilderness with really nothing to his name. And for weeks, he lived off the land with no help and no connection to any other human. However, after about 2 months, he had enough of living alone and decided to return to society. Unfortunately for him, the small stream he had crossed to get to where he was now a surging river from the melting snow and the runoff, and he believed there was no way to pass that river. Little did he know, just 1 mile downstream was a hand trolley that would have easily got him across the river. Just 6 miles south of the bus where he was found was a cabin that was used for hikers and for hunters, and that cabin was stocked full with emergency supplies like food and water and even some heat sources as well. The cabin was clearly marked on most local maps, including the map that the last kind person offered him. Eventually, he wrote this in his journal, pictured here on the screen: "Rained in, river looks impossible, lonely, scared." From that point on, his journal entries became shorter and shorter and much more dire. His last entry that he wrote words on was on day 107, and he simply said this: "Beautiful blueberries." The final 6 days of his life, there were no words, just a slash for every day that he lived until he passed. While the whole story really captured my attention, I was truly taken by one quote found in the margin of his journal on one of the pages, and here is the quote: "Happiness is only real when shared." Wow. Happiness is only real when shared. Or in other words, it's not good for man to be alone. Does that sound familiar? It should, especially if you're familiar with the Bible at all, because that's what God said about us. At the very beginning of our story, this page-turning story that he's inviting us all into, all the way back in the very first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. If you don't know, the start of Genesis records God's creation of everything that we know. The sun, the moon, the stars, the land, the sea, the animals, even humanity. And after everything God created, he said, it is good. Only one time in the entire creation account did God say something was not good. And it's found in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. And it says this, "Then the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone." Which, by the way, this is important for us to note. It's not my sermon, but I feel like I need to include it in my sermon. God did not say that it's not good for man to be single. That's not what he said, okay? Yes, this is where God institutes the marriage covenant, but this statement was not a statement about marriage. It was a statement about community. That's not good for man to be alone. We don't need marriage to thrive. We don't. If we need marriage to thrive, then Jesus Christ himself couldn't thrive. Because Jesus, while he walked the earth, was single his entire life. So we don't need marriage to thrive, but we do need community. It's been a part of God's design in our story from the very beginning. In fact, community, or the search for community, is really a part of every great story. I can't think of one page-turning story that doesn't involve a community, or a search for a community, or a tragic ending because of a lack of community, much like we saw in the story of Chris McCandless. It's not good for man to be alone. Our need for community is a part of the page-turning story that God's invited us all into. It contributes to our thriving because it gives us the strength that we need. Which leads right into the big idea for today, and it's this. You can survive without being in community, but you'll struggle to have the strength that you need. You can survive without being in good, strong community. I mean, Chris McCandless survived for a while without community. Adam, in the creation story, he could have survived without community, but without community, it's nearly impossible for us to thrive as human beings. Without true community, you'll struggle to have the strength that you need. So, here's the big question we've got to ask today. What kind of community provides the strength that we need? What kind of community provides the strength that we need? And I know I'm a little bit of a distraction today. I'm wearing my Oklahoma Sooner gear, and I got my Oklahoma Sooner mug. Boomer Sooner! I've got boos and hisses. This is intense, folks. So let's go ahead and pray for people who cheer for fill in the blank. Because we all got them, right? I can't believe I got hisses. In both services, people were hissing at me. Like, this is real. There are lots of places in Scripture we could look at today, but we're going to look at our main Scripture, Galatians 6, 1 through 3, found in the New Testament portion of the Bible. You can follow along on the screens in the Harbor app, or I always would encourage you and challenge you to bring your own Bible, either a hard copy or an app on your phone. We are looking at this from a Christian perspective based on what the Bible says. But really, even if you're not a follower of Jesus, even if you don't believe in the Bible, this principle is still true for you. Like, we all need community. It's a part of our story. It's how we're wired. It's why solitary confinement is a punishment. Because we're not meant to live alone. And you don't have to believe what we do in order to be loved and accepted here. As long as you understand, like, here at the Harbor, we do believe that God created us, and he created us for community, and since he's the one that thought of it, he might have a way for us to receive it. And so we're going to look at that today, a way in which community will help provide us with the strength that we need. And please understand, like, I fully believe that Jesus is our strength. I believe that. That's what we looked at last week. We looked at that, how Jesus is the hero of our story. However, while Jesus is our strength, more often than not, he will use community as the conduit in which to provide it. That was good preaching, so I'll say it again. Jesus is our strength, but more often than not, he will use community as a conduit in which to provide that strength. So, Galatians 6, verse 1, the Apostle Paul writing here to a group of Christians in the town of Galatia, ultimately to all those who would believe in Jesus, says this: "Dear friends, dear brothers and sisters," I might want to read it right, "if another believer is overcome by some sin, some struggle in their life, you who are godly should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path and be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself." So what kind of community gives us the strength we need? There's dozens of things we could talk about. We only have time for three that I see in this passage. And the first thing I see is this: a community that is safe. A community that's safe. Now, I know that not every community has been safe for everyone. I get that. Sadly, not even every Christian community has been safe for everyone. Dr. Freddie Gage, longtime evangelist in the Southern Baptist Church, said this: "The Christian army is the only army that shoots and buries its wounded." That's heavy. And for some people, that's been your story, or the story of someone that you love. You were wounded, shot, and buried emotionally or spiritually by the very people who should have cared for you. And if that's you, I'm sorry. My heart hurts deeply every time I hear of another person who was wounded, shot, buried by the church or by Christian people. And I hope you know that those people or those churches or that thing that was done to you is not a reflection of Jesus or how he feels about you. Amen. And that's why this passage should be a challenge for all of us, me included, to make sure we are safe people, creating safe community, because it's only through a community that's safe where we will develop the strength that we need. Galatians 6 verse 1 said, we should be helping each other stay on or get on the right path, but we do that with gentleness and humility. Talk about two words that describe safety: gentle and humble. But are those two words we would use to describe how God's church responds to people or things today? Gentle and humble. Friends, may we never forget that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us. That every single one of us are one bad decision away from doing the worst thing we've ever done in our lives. That should create a little bit of humility in us. That it's a me too kind of attitude, not a how could you kind of attitude. Now, this doesn't mean that we don't also present truth to people, or that we don't protect people from those who are trying to injure them. Part of safety is guiding people onto the right path, which requires some truth-telling, or it requires protecting people from those who are trying to attack. So it's not just being gentle and humble and then leaving people in their sin or their struggle or just letting them injure people in our community. It's also standing with them and supporting them as we help them back onto the right path, or as we come against those who are causing injury or harm. And that's really what the next verse talks about in our community. Verse 2 of our main scripture says this: share each other's burdens, and in this way, obey the law of Christ. You can survive without being in community, but you'll struggle to have the strength you need. So what kind of community will provide or give us the strength that we need? A community that is safe, that's marked by gentleness and humility, even when we have to speak truth that may not be well received, we do so with a gentle and a humble heart, knowing that we ourselves have received the mercy of God, and nothing in ourselves can ever make us godly. Only the godliness of Jesus can make us godly. So we gently and humbly provide safety for people to get them on the right path or come against those who are causing harm. But the second thing is this: we also need to have a community that's supportive. A community that's supportive. That we bear each other's burdens. And here's why we need a community that's safe and supportive. Because we have a very real enemy. And his name is the devil. And here's what the Apostle Peter, one of the 12 apostles of Jesus, said about the devil in his letter, 1 Peter 5, verse 8 in the New Testament. He said this: stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Now, I know this might be a shock to some of you, but I am not a lion expert. You probably thought I was. But I am not. But from what I understand about lions, mostly from, you know, Discovery Channel, is that they stalk their prey. They prowl around looking for something to devour. And almost every time they wait until an animal is isolated from the herd, and then they attack. In fact, lions are much less likely to attack an animal, even an injured one, if it's inside the herd. It's almost like the animal kingdom has figured out what God's kingdom still struggles with.
Amen.
As I was doing some digging into how lions attack and how the animal kingdom responds, I discovered that elephants are really, really good at protecting each other from attack, supporting each other. And in fact, check out this picture here. This picture is of a herd of elephants who have formed a barricade around one single elephant. What you can't see on the inside of that barricade is a mother elephant giving birth to a calf. In her most vulnerable moment, as she was giving birth to a child, her community rallied around her to protect her. Isn't that awesome? Here's a beautiful black and white picture of another elephant herd, and there was a lion that was nearby, and so this elephant herd gathered around in the middle. What you can't see in the middle is a newborn calf. It's a separate herd, but a baby calf, a lion was nearby, and these elephants gathered around the baby calf to support and protect it. I love this little guy right there. Like, he's like bowing up, like lion, bring it on, man. And I promise you, if that little guy was by himself, he could do nothing. But in community, he's strong. Because he's standing next to the giant dude right there. And he's saying, man, bring it on. I got my community. And you ain't touching that person on the inside. That's how they support the weak. the sick, the broken, the most vulnerable. And friends, that picture right there should be what God's church looks like. If you're in a small group, and many of you are, we believe it's the best place for us to get connected and start taking our steps to grow more like Jesus. Like, that picture is what our small groups should look like. And I know that many of them are. There should be safety in our community, helping each other stay on or get on the right path to find hope and healing with gentleness and humility, receiving people into our community in all their weakness, all their brokenness, with grace and love and care and concern, remembering that we too are weak and broken people. There should also be support, a sharing of one another's burdens, that when one person is battered or broken or weary or worn, we gather around them to protect them from the enemy, to keep them safe while Jesus restores and refuels their strength so that they can return to their life and help other people do the same. And if you call the harbor your home, I hope you just caught our vision there. It was subtle, but I said it. Like, that's our vision, to restore those who are battered and broken, refuel those weary and worn, and return to our lives with Jesus at the center, changing our world one life at a time. Do you think what those elephants did mattered to the one elephant on the inside the circle? And the same's true for us. When we rally around those who are battered and broken, weary and worn, it matters to that one life that might be changed. But here's the more difficult part. For a lot of us, we have no problem supporting someone else's burden. We just don't want to let other people support ours. We don't want to share our burdens. We don't want to let other people know about our weakness and our brokenness. Like, we have no problem being safe and supportive for other people as long as I don't have to be transparent and vulnerable myself. And listen, if I ask for a show of hands of people who struggle with this, my hand will be the first one up. Like, you know, so many times in my life, I've gone through seasons where the voice of the enemy said, "You can't tell anybody that. You're a pastor." But if I'm not willing to be transparent and vulnerable, I will struggle to find the strength that I need. And so I need a group of people around me where I'm safe and supported to do that. And so do you. Pastor Craig Rochelle of Life Church in Oklahoma City said this: "You're only as strong as you are honest." And in saying that, he wasn't just talking about being a truthful person. He was talking about being a transparent person. That not everyone should know everything about you, but someone should. Or a group of someones who are safe and supportive, because you're only as strong as you are honest. At some point, your strength will be limited by what you are willing to share with others. And listen, every group and every ministry that we have at the harbor should be a place where anything can be shared and you are safe and you are supported. And this doesn't mean that anything shared will be approved of. It's a big difference. Like, there might need to be some humble and gentle correction as we lead people back onto the right path, or some safety provided for other people to keep them from harm. But our love and support of you is not based on sins in your life or skeletons in your closet. Let me say that again. Here at the harbor, our love for you is not based on what sins are in your life or what skeletons are in your closet. That we want to provide safety and support for whatever is happening in your life. You can survive without being a community, but you'll struggle to have the strength that you need. So what kind of community provides the strength that we need? A community that is safe, marked with gentleness and humility. A community where there is support, where we are sharing one another's burdens, being real and raw about what's going on in life. And then the last thing, the three, is this: a community that serves. A community that serves. Paul ends our little main scripture today in Galatians 6, verse 3, by saying this, and I'll just tell you, buckle up. If you think you are too important to help someone, to serve someone, you are only fooling yourself. You are not that important. Dang. Like, all of us should memorize that and say it at the very start of every day. I am not that important. Or as the Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 12, something very similar. I'd encourage you to read all of Romans 12. It really is a beautiful picture of how God's community should interact. Romans 12, verse 3, Paul says this: because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. And then he goes on to say, from that we should love each other with a genuine affection, that we should take delight in honoring each other, that we should help those who are in need, that we should be happy with those who are happy and weep with those who weep. Or in other words, we should be safe, we should be supportive, and we should be serving those who are in our community. It's the kind of community that provides the strength we need. And it's the kind of community a man named Randy McGraw had. Randy was my age and a part of our church in Wyoming for many years. Following some tragic circumstances, complications from a surgery and then ongoing health issues, Randy passed away a couple years ago. But all through his struggle, even up to the week he died, he stayed connected to his small group. He was attending his men's small group from his hospital bed on video up until the week he passed. His wife, after he passed, said their family would not have made it through that season were it not for his group's safety, support, and service. She said they brought so much encouragement to him that when he was having a rough day, they would pray over him. When he was angry, they would hear him out. When he was discouraged, they would give him hope. When he was scared, they would help calm his fears. But the one thing that stood out to me the most was found in his obituary. I mean, you want to talk about real community. I had never seen this before in my life or in my ministry. It blew me away that at his funeral, which I was a part of, listed among his family in the obituary as people who survived him was his small group. Friends, that's the kind of community that we each need. Safe, supportive, and serving. So what do we do with that? It's challenging for me. So what do we do with that? Well, the first thing you might do is ask this question. Is that the kind of person I am? Am I safe? Am I supportive? Am I willing to serve anyone who's around me? If you want to be really brave, ask those who are closest to you, who know you the most. Is that the kind of person I am? Safe, supportive, and serving. If you're in a small group, I would challenge you to have your group ask that question. Are we that kind of group? Are we safe? Are we supportive? Are we serving one another and those around us? I mean, that really is the goal, to be safe, supportive, and, and serve me? So you should start there. Ask that question. The second thing you might do if you're not currently in a small group is to get in one. And as luck would have it, we have the gathering for our small groups today, immediately following this service, up in the foundry, which is all the way down the hallways, up in the third floor of the far end of our building there. Free childcare, free food. Pastor Robert, our small groups pastor, will cast vision for small groups, tell you about how we do small groups, how they function. Some of our small group leaders will be there, and you can get plugged in right now to a small group if you are not in one. And I would just say this too. Once you sign up for a small group, you're not locked into that small group for eternity. If that group doesn't work for you, we'll help you find one that does. Not every group is for every person, but we should have a group for every person. And if we're truly living this out, being safe and supportive, if somebody attends your group and doesn't like it, we won't be offended when they leave. We'll actually be servants and say, let me help you find one. Right? So get in the small group. Like, we all need to be in community. We have several recovery and support groups here at the Harbor as well. You might want to check out what we offer there on our ministry page for specific support and recovery needs. One I'll tell you about is we are excited about expanding our Revive Recovery ministry to include recovery for drug and alcohol addiction for men. We only have a men's group available right now. On our dream and prayer list is adding a women's part as well, but we are adding a men's support and recovery group for drug and alcohol addiction. It begins, yeah, it's awesome. It begins the week of September 12th. And the reason we don't give the specific date, time, or location is because we create great amounts of safety and anonymity. It's a hard word to say. For those who come. It's not an open group. You can't just show up. You got to go to our website, theharbor.life, go to the events page, click on Revive, and then follow the instructions there. You got to reach out to someone from our Revive team. They will have a conversation with you to let you know all the things that you need to know. And in this group, there is massive amounts of hope given to those who are struggling with addiction, along with tools for you to take your next step in your recovery. And then lastly, I would just say this might be you today. You might have come today with a burden. It's a heavy burden, emotionally, spiritually, relationally, whatever it is. And maybe you just need to tell somebody. And I would encourage you to tell our prayer team. As soon as I'm done here in just a moment, to my right, your left, we'll have a whole group of people who would be honored to serve you by praying for your need. They are safe. They're going to be supportive. And they're going to serve you right now in this moment to seek God on your behalf for whatever is happening in your life. You can survive without community, but you'll struggle to have the strength you need. So what kind of community provides the strength we need? A safe one, a supportive one, and a serving one. And my prayer is me and all of us who call the Harbor home and believe in and follow Jesus would live that out for our community. Maybe you would sign up to serve on Compassion Weekend. You realize that we go out and serve our community, what we are saying to our neighbors is we are safe. We support you in your needs, and we're going to serve you to be the hands and feet of Jesus. My wife and I have already signed up to serve on Compassion Day on that Saturday. I would challenge you to as well. Let me pray for you. Father in heaven, thank you that in Jesus you modeled this perfectly. That Jesus, our Lord, you were safe for us. You supported us in all of our burden and sin, and you served us with the ultimate sacrifice of dying in our place to forgive us and set us free. And so Jesus, as those of us who follow you, may we follow your example in being and providing a community that is safe and supportive and serving. May that define who we are as a community of believers together. We love you, Jesus, and we give you praise. In your name, amen. Love you guys so much. Have an awesome week. You're dismissed.